Get ready for the Sensex at 1 lakh. And if things go well, maybe even 1,30,000. Morgan Stanley has great expectations of the Indian economy based on the jam plus GST combination. And let me explain that. Now, please. This is the subject matter of a 125-page report led by Rhythm. And there are about 20 contributors to it from across the world, including the India team. So there's no way I'm going to be able to bring you all the details in the next few minutes, right? So I'll just give you the key takeaways, and then I would urge you to go to BloombergQuint.com and read the rest over the course of the day. But the big thing they're betting on is the digitization of the economy. So you've got the jam trinity, you've got GST, and between both of these, they're saying that we will end up creating significant big data in this country. Big data on taxpayers, big data on tax habits, big data on cash flow for companies, big data on bank lending, big data on personal credit. So all of this put together will mean substantial gains, or how do I put it? Not substantial gains, but big boost to credit flows and substantial gains for the economy. Let me break that down a little bit and give you some key takeaways. For instance, the report says that they expect that lending will move from collateral-based lending to working capital-based lending. So because this big data will allow banks to keep track of the working capital of firms over extended periods of time, small and medium enterprises will find it easier to be able to get credit at cheaper rates, and therefore rates of credit to that part of the economy will grow and grow as substantially as 17% CAGR. So that's one key takeaway. Big shift in credit culture. And so they expect that consumer credit will also grow very rapidly. The growth rate number positioned for that is also 17%. And let me add here, these are all projections for 10 years, so 2027. Anytime between now and 2027, some of this could become true. Higher government revenue, thanks to GST, once it stabilizes and all of that, will mean a lower public debt to GDP ratio, which is a salutary impact on the economy. E-commerce sales, they say, will touch 200 billion in terms of GMVs by 2027. And they're positioning India as a $6 trillion economy in the next 10 years. So that becomes the third largest economy in the world. And this will be a big driver for the equity bull market. Now, they've put in some forecasts. You may shrug, you may giggle. These are 10-year forecasts. And we're struggling right now with two-month forecasts. But this is what they're suggesting the economy will look like. So they're saying, like I said, GDP will come in somewhere around $6 trillion. Mutual fund AUMs. So currently 273 billion. Their bull case for 2027 is $3.415 billion. This is, or 1.93. Okay. Not 1.93 billion. Substantially, 1,935 billion. Right. Sorry, and 3,415 billion. Yeah. So that's what they're positioning for mutual funds. They've got lots of data out there. I won't take you through all of it, but I'll take you through the number that everybody will be watching, which is the Sensex, currently at about 31,000 levels. Bull case scenario 1,30,000. Base case scenario 1 lakh. Bear case scenario 65,000. So that's the view out from 10 years. And they've also put in a list of stocks they like based on this entire stratagem, if you may call it that. And let me take you very, very quickly through what that list of stocks says. I'm just pulling it up for you. There you've got it. You've got both financials, so those will come up. And on top of that list is Bajaj Finance, Edelweiss, HDFC Bank. They've got housing finance through LIC Housing Finance. You've got ICICI Prudential for the insurance play, M&M Financial. So financials is the big pick. Yeah. And then they've got consumers, which is the second big pick. So you've got Asian Paints, ITC. These are all stocks that Morgan Stanley believes will benefit from these trends that they've laid out in the report. Eicher Motors, Maruti Suzuki, Ultratech Cement. So that's the Morgan Stanley 10-year strategy. I'm not sure we'll be around in 10 years from now to check if any of this comes true.
Of course we will be.
Maybe.
Let's be bullish.
Yeah, but we'll get a chance to talk to Rhythm about this. So it'll be interesting to see how he explains some of the findings of this report. So,
I don't know what stood out for Ira. What stood out for me, and I'm just straight away going to the last part of this report that you highlighted, Venga. It's all about banking and consumption. There is, I'm sure there are others, but in the large list, there is but one economy facing company.
You know, I asked him this question when we were talking about this yesterday. They had a select group of journalists over to talk about this, and I said, what kind of list is this that you're talking about? If Bajaj Finance tops the list and ITC is in the consumer pack, this is hardly even a list to talk about, right? Yeah. I mean, some of us could put this list together without help from Morgan Stanley. So he did admit that they are constrained by market cap parameters.
Got
because these are the recommendations they make to their clients. And so therefore, they don't recommend stocks that are below certain market cap parameters. Yeah. So therefore, you know, and then he had some valuation concerns as well. So I think, you know, when asked why ITC and why not maybe any other consumer goods, consumer company, I think some he had an issue on valuations, others he thought in market cap terms were too small.
I think what was strange to me is that in all of this, they don't have, except for perhaps UltraTech, which you could consider a play on the
real estate
story, they don't have anything which is investment facing.
Yeah, investment.
To me, it's absolutely confounding. I mean, I completely get the consumer story, but the investment story has to pick up, otherwise we are in a lot of long-term trouble.
So I think if you look at the NBFC and the bank play and the financial services play, maybe the only
all
exposure
of them are
to investment.
Guys. Yeah, but they're
yeah,
all...
HDFC is consumer.
HDFC is consumer.
Life insurance
Bajaj
is consumer.
Bajaj is consumer. Yeah. ICICI Pru is consumer.
Kotak is consumer.
Kotak is consumer. If they put an ICICI bank, an Axis bank or an SBI in there, I would have said, okay, maybe they're playing the investment theme through that. So, I mean, it's just... it's strange. Nobody wants to play the investment theme in, you know, India without investment is not going
to play
going nowhere.
All questions we will put to Rhythm Desai, I'm sure, at some point. But, you know, just to, I know because we debated this with him quite a bit yesterday, I suspect this list has more to do with the theme that they're talking about, which is digitization, therefore a big move in corporate credit, personal credit. But yeah, investment...
It has to come back to investment.
Investment, yeah. And real estate didn't because it was of market cap parameters.
No, but one simple point out here, to play the devil's advocate, it may not mean that they don't have those plays in their priority list,
sure.
But it may not be the top performing companies over 10 years.
Oh, by the way.
And therefore, this is a list of their top performing companies.
Over 10 years, right? So, so the point is that if you're expecting consumption to pick up, demand to pick up, and investment has been slow, so investment companies have not seen the kind of traction that consumer companies have, then the upside should actually come on investment companies.
But their models might still be showing, Ira. I completely get your point, but I'm just playing the devil's advocate. The models might still show that over a 10-year period, Bajaj Finance could still outperform, for argument's sake, a Larsen & Toubro. Is my limited point.
Could very well. Look, who knows what happens in a 10-year period. But look, the guys at Morgan Stanley have been working very hard because they also put out, along with this 125-page 2027 report, a 12-month view on the economy, rupee and equities.
Is that positive?
Yeah, it is.
It is.
So yesterday, Rhythm said that he thought the economy had troughed out.
Wow.
And he said that, in fact, he thought that there were signs of recovery even before demonetization last year. We have some of those pointers on a graphic plate. It's also on our website, BloombergQuinn.com. I can very quickly take you through what they've said there. So they've said that the economy has troughed out. We can expect strong earnings growth. We should expect strong merger and acquisition activity. This is something he's been talking about for many, many months now. Meaningful uptick in equity supply. The global bull market as the backdrop helps in, you know, feeling more bullish about equities. And then this is the quote from the report. We also don't think the market is pricing in a multi-year growth cycle, implying meaningful upside potential to stocks over the next 3 to 5 years. So they're bullish on the 12-month period. They're bullish 3 to 5 years. They're bullish 10 years. Right now, everything's looking good at Morgan Stanley, right? And then they've put a list of stocks to avoid. Now, that's a very interesting list. We won't give it away on this show. You'll just have to take the effort to go to our site, which is BloombergQuinn.com. And there's a list of stocks to avoid on a 12-month basis that Morgan Stanley has put out. So you can go take a look at what they think you should be underweight on.